वेलकम अगेन इन दिस AECC एजुकेशन यूट्यूब चैनल दैट इज एनेस्थेसिया इमरजेंसी क्रिटिकल केयर एजुकेशन. टुडे आई विल डिस्कस अबाउट द एक्यूट रेस्पिरेटरी डिस्ट्रेस सिंड्रोम. लेट्स स्टार्ट. सो लेट्स बिगिन. द हिस्ट्री ऑफ दिस ARDS बिगिन्स इन 1967 बाय एस्बॉक एट ऑल गिवन दिस टर्म ARDS एंड व्हेन ही रिपोर्टेड 12% विद सडन रेस्पिरेटरी फेल्योर on the basis of rapidly developed acute hypoxemia, stiff lung, bilateral diffuse alveolar infiltrate on chest x-ray, and it is developed only after few days of the precipitating factor. And very interesting, none of these patients have any underlying cardiac or respiratory problem. The outcome were very poor. Out of 12, 7 died. Later on, in 1971, the Petty and Asbach define the management of this ARDS on the basis of mechanical ventilation by using high FiO2 and positive inexpirative. So first clinical definition of this acute respiratory distress syndrome was published by Bernard et al. In 1994 after the American-European Consensus Conference on ARDS. It defines the ARDS on the basis of following criteria. The first one is the acute onset of hypoxemia. The PF ratio is less than or equal to 200 mmHg regardless of the PEEP level. It is very important. The presence of bilateral infiltrate on the chest x-ray and the pulmonary artery wedge pressure less than or equal to 18 mmHg or no clinical sign of cardiogenic pulmonary edema. It also defined the acute lung injury if the PF ratio is in between to 201 to 300. Now this definition is very much criticized by the Fua et al. And then in 2012, the Berlin definition was published in JAMA. And on the basis of this Berlin definition of ARDS, the timing should be within the 1 week of a non-clinical insert or new or worsening respiratory symptoms. On the chest imaging, there should be the bilateral opacity and that not fully explained by the effusion, lower or lung collapse or the nodules. And the origin of edema, that is the respiratory failure, is not fully explained by the cardiac failure or the fluid overload, both. And it needs the objective assessment by doing the echocardiography to exclude the hydrostatic edema if there is no risk factors present. It should not, in this Berlin definition, they didn't include the pulmonary artery wedge pressure. On the basis of PF ratio, this ARDS is stratified into the mild, moderate and severe form. The mild ARDS when the PF ratio is 200 to 300, moderate when PF ratio is 101 to 200 and severe when the PF ratio is less than 100 mmHg. As a major limitation of the AECC definition was assessment of PF ratio regardless of the positive inexpiratory pressure level, the Berlin definition used here the PEEP level of at least 5 cm of H2O or CPAP of at least 5 cm of H2O. But in this definition also a major limitation is that the severity can be assessed on a single blood gas measurement without prior standardization of ventilator setting, including the positive inexpiratory pressure, which may have a major influence on oxygenation. Coming to the pathophysiology of ARDS, as we know that the ARDS is an acute inflammatory lung condition, and not a disease. Therefore, is always precipitated by an underlying process, and that underlying process may be pulmonary or extrapulmonary lung injury. Extrapulmonary lung injury like acute pancreatitis or sepsis and other causes. This pathophysiology progresses into three different phases. The first phase is the acute inflammatory phase, second phase is the proliferative phase, and third phase is the fibrotic phase. This one is the second, this one is the second, this is the third, and the first is the inflammatory phases. So in the first phase or inflammatory phases, there is damage of this alveolar and the capillary barrier leading to the pulmonary edema. The pulmonary epithelial and endothelial cellular damage is characterized by the inflammation because of the inflammatory cells. Then because of the inflammation, there is apoptosis and necrosis both, and then increase alveolar and the capillary permeability. And because of that, there is bidirectional leakage of the protein and fluid into the alveolus and as well as the plasma. And because of the damage of the epithelial cell, there is injury of the type 2 alveolar cell, and because of that, there is sulfuric dysfunction. And finally, all this causes the collapse of the lung, alveoli collapse, and that lead to the hypoxemia. In the proliferative phase, the improved lung function and healing occurs, and in the fibrotic phase, because of the healing, because it signifies there is end of the acute disease process and there is a fibrosis of the lung. Now, how will you manage such patients? So, on the basis of Berlin definition, if you establish the ARDS, then first thing we have to do the identify and the treat the cause which causes this ARDS. Like if the patient has the urosepsis or patient has the acute pancreatitis, then you have to treat the primary cause as well. The most important thing I have to discuss here is the lung protective mechanical ventilation and then other adjunctive treatment. So what is the meaning of the lung protective mechanical ventilation? It will protect the lung from the volutrauma, from the barotrauma, from the atelectrauma, from the biotrauma, and ultimately it will reduce the ventilator induced lung injury. What is the volutrauma? Volutrauma is due to the over distension of the compliant alveoli because of the excessive linear strain pattern on the alveoli. The barotrauma is because of the high inspiratory pressure, that is the stress factor. And atelectrauma or shear stress, what is that? It is due to the cyclic opening or closing of the collapsed alveoli and the alveolar duct units. Because of that, shear forces generate and it can reach up to the more centimeter, up to the 140 centimeter of water. Even when we are keeping the plateau pressure of less than 30 centimeter water, it will help to prevent the barotrauma as well as the volutrauma. But even keeping the plateau pressure of less than 30, it will not help to prevent the shear stress. So just limiting the plateau pressure of less than 30 centimeter, we can't say we are preventing the ventilator induced lung injury. And finally, all this trauma, volutrauma, barotrauma, and the atelectotrauma leads to the biotrauma. What is that biotrauma? Biotrauma is the release of inflammatory mediators from the lung. All this trauma leads to the ventilator induced lung injury, and it can occur at the end of the inspiration, it is because of the volutrauma or barotrauma, or at the beginning of the inspiration because of the atelectrauma. So this protective ventilation strategy will prevent both stress and strain at the end of the inspiration as well as at the end of the expiration. Then what should be the ventilatory strategy in case of the ARDS? So as we know, this article published by the Ferguson, even in case of the mild, moderate and severe ARDS, the tidal volume always should be the low. Why low tidal volume? It can be understood by the baby lung concept. What is that baby lung concept? Baby lung is a physiological concept, meaning that due to the large amount of non-aerated lung, the remaining normally aerated lung accessible to ventilation is considerably reduced and is the similar size as that of a baby. So look here, only this part of lung is aerated lung. Here only this part of lung is aerated lung. So the amount of aerated lung which helps to exchange of the gas is very much reduced. Hence, so we have to decrease the tidal volume as well. Then how can we decide whether this patient required the non-invasive ventilator support or invasive ventilator support? So non-invasive ventilator support you have to give mainly in case of mild ARDS, who is hemodynamically stable, easily oxygenated, and does not need the immediate intubation and has no contraindication to use. It is only used in the less severely ill patient, and close monitoring is very much needed in the mild if you are putting the patient on the NIV, because if you are not properly monitor such patient, that lead to the adverse outcome and the increased mortality of the patient. Now, when to go for the invasive mechanical ventilation? So if the patient has worsening respiratory fatigue because of the increased work of breathing, patient using the accessory muscles, the respiratory rate is increased. In that condition, you have to go for the invasive mechanical ventilation as soon as possible. If the patient has the persistent hypoxemia, SpO2 is less than 90%, even on the non-rebreathing face mask oxygen, NIV or high flow nasal cannula, and worsening hypercarbia, it means there is very much less gas diffusion. Now, which mode? You can put the patient on the volume control, assist volume control mode, or pressure control mode, assist pressure control mode. Whether the pressure control ventilation mode can reduce the ventilator associated lung injury compared to the volume control is a matter of debate. So you can go for the both mode. In the ARDS network protocol, they use the volume control ventilation. And if you are using the pressure control ventilation, then always you have to target the preset volume on the basis of peak inspiratory pressure and the PIP, and the gradient of this difference of this pressure will decide the tidal volume. So always keep an eye on the tidal volume. So if the patient is improving, then you have to decrease the PIP and always maintain the tidal volume of at least 6 ml per kg. So no pressure control only, pressure control mode will helpful for the better patient asynchrony because of initial high flow, but we have to strictly monitor the tidal volume and keep adjusting the pressure. That is the peak inspiratory pressure, and try to keep the tidal volume up to the 6 ml per kg of the predicted body weight. Now, coming to the acute respiratory distress syndrome network guideline for the ventilatory strategy in case of the acute respiratory distress syndrome patient. So, what would be the initial ventilator setting? And you should calculate the predicted body weight for such patients. So, for male, it would be the 50 plus 2, 23 into height in inches minus 60, and for female the 50 is replaced by 45.5. Then put the patient on the volume assist control mode. Initial tidal volume is 6 ml per kg of the predicted body weight, and this is very important, always try to match the baseline minute ventilation. It means if the patient before intubating, the patient has the very high minute ventilation, patient has the respiratory rate of 30 or 35, then try to achieve that amount of minute ventilation after the intubation as well, because patient maintaining their pH by doing high much amount of by increasing the minute ventilation. So whenever you are putting the patient on the mechanical ventilation, try to increase the ventilatory respiratory rate and achieve that amount of desired minute ventilation by increasing the respiratory rate of at least equal or less than 35 breaths per minute. The next question is how to adjust the subsequent tidal volume. So it is on the basis of P plateau pressure. How will you measure this P plateau pressure? 0.5 second inspiratory pause at least every 4 hours or after each change in P or tidal volume. If the P plat is less more than 30 cm water, then decrease the tidal volume by 1 ml per kg, step by step, go 5, then go up to the 4. If the P plat is less than 25 cm water, then and tidal volume is less than 6 ml per kg, then increase the tidal volume by 1 and try to achieve the P plat more than 25% or tidal volume of 6 ml per kg. If you are seeing any auto P, patient has the breath staking, severe dyspnea, in that condition, you can go up to the tidal volume of 7 to 8 ml per kg, but mind it, your P plat should be less than 30 cm of water. Now, what will be your oxygenation goal? The oxygenation goal should be the 55 to 80 PO2. In our scenario, we can take up to the 60, we can take up to the 60, and SpO2 88 to 95%. So use this table for the FI2 and PIF combination. So always PIFs should be applied starting with the minimum value of given FI2. So if the patient on the FI2 of 0.4%, 40%, then your PIF can go up to the 8. Now, what you are trying to achieve, the goal of ventilation should be the oxygenation goal, already discussed. Plateau pressure should be less than equal to 30. pH goal, you can go up to the pH of 7.30, that is the permissive hypercapnia. Because of the permissive hypercapnia, pH will decrease up to the 7.30. okay, so if the pH is decreased less than 7.30, then you can increase the respiratory rate up to the 35, and even that, if the pH is less than 7.15, then you can add the bicarb. Now, driving pressure, this is very important, a very important concept we have to discuss here. So always keep the driving pressure less than 40 centimeter of H2O, and many this driving pressure nowadays very useful, and it will be very helpful to reduce the ventilator induced lung injury, and a lot of trial is going on. Very soon we have very good data on the basis of driving pressure to manage the ARDS patient. So what is that driving pressure? Driving pressure, that tidal volume is not the final determinant of the lung injury. As we already discussed here, in the ARDS network protocol, they are mainly stressing on the low tidal volume mechanical ventilation. Why not? Why not tidal volume is not the final determinant of lung injury? Because we know that in the healthier lung, if the FRC is 2000 ml, and in case of the wet lung like ARDS, because here the wet lung, so now the FRC is reduced to 2000 to the 500 ml, and if you are giving the tidal volume of 400 ml here and here, then the strain is very high in this condition, because FRC is mainly the 500 ml. As we know that strain is equal to tidal volume divided by FRC, so here the FRC is decreases from 2000 ml to 500 ml, so this strain is very high in case of the ARDS. The another thing is very important is that there is regional lung strain. So some of the alveoli has the very high strain, some of the alveoli is the aerated, this is the non-aerated, because of that very high strain pattern, this is aerated lung, not any inflammatory exudate, so less strain. So there is more shear process, there is more stress, and there is chances of the atelectroma. This driving pressure, it will helpful to measure the global lung strain. How can? Because we will discuss in the next slide, it includes the respiratory system compliance, and respiratory compliance mainly correlates with the aerated lung volume, not the long non-aerated lung volume. So this is very good article published by Marcelo et al, that is the driving pressure and survival in the acute respiratory distress syndrome. And this driving pressure is an independent risk factor for the mortality, and we can use it to prognosticate the patient along with the other factors. So what is the definition? It is a very simple definition. The driving pressure is equal to P plateau pressure, this is the P plateau pressure, and minus P, so this is the driving pressure. How will it will be helpful? So it combines both plateau pressure and the P. So as we already discussed in the ARDS network, we have to keep the P plat is the less than 30 centimeter water. So here it includes both plateau pressure and P. So if the patient has higher P plat, it can induce the ventilator lung induced. Even in case of the lower P, it can also cause the ventilator induced lung injury. A lot of controversy about the P, we will discuss in later on. And the second thing, as we know that the compliance is equal to delta V by delta P. So here is the delta V is the expired tidal volume divided by the P plat minus P, that is the compliance of the respiratory system or static compliance, and this is the delta P. So delta P is equal to tidal volume divided by the respiratory system compliance. So this driving pressure also tells about the compliance of the respiratory system, and compliance of the respiratory system is mainly defined by the aerated lung volume. So this driving pressure help in managing the patient by prognostication of the patients, determine whether change in PEEP or recruitment maneuver is helpful or not, and what will we do if the PEEP plate is more than 30. So how can we determine whether the PEEP or this is important recruitment maneuver is beneficial or not? So this article, which is published by the Barcelo, it is in the discussion part, they given the very important message that our finding might also explain why the studies of higher PEEP did not show the consistent survival benefit. Still, we are telling that if the patient has the refractory hypoxemia, patient is not improving, then try to increase the PEEP. But many of the studies showing that increasing the PEEP is not will be very useful, and there is no consistent survival benefit. So Marcelo published this article, and on the basis of this article, he also tells that this driving pressure, it also tells about why the higher PEEP is not giving the survival benefit. So PEEP increment might be protective. PEEP increment might be protective when the increased PEEP value result in change in the lung mechanics. So just see whether your while managing your patient, ARDS patient, by increasing the PEEP, whether it affects the change in lung mechanics or not, so that the same tidal volume can be delivered at a lower driving pressure. So see here. So if you are increasing the pressure, increasing the PEEP value, then see whether this driving pressure is decreased or not. If the driving pressure is decreased by increasing the PEEP, it means the lung of the patient is a recruitable lung. If the driving pressure is not decreased, other than it increased, it means this increasing PEEP will over distended the lung alveoli, and that lung is de-recruitable lung. At the same time, as I also said, the driving pressure is equal to the tidal volume divided the compliance. So see whether the compliance is increased or not increased by increasing the PEEP value. If compliance is increased, means lung is recruitable. If compliance is decreased, it means lung is de-recruitable or over-distended lung. So what is that recruitment? Recruitment is the application of the airway pressure it will increase the transpulmonary pressure to open up the closed non-compliant alveoli and make them participate in the gas exchange. That is the functional recruitment, not anatomical recruitment. How will we do the recruitment maneuver? So 40 cm of CPAP for 30 to 40 seconds, or by using with the patient on the controlled ventilation, patient is sedated, paralyzed, then a series of pressure control ventilation with the PIP of 40 to 50 cm or PEEP of 25 to 35 cm for 2 to 3 minutes, and always start with the 40-20, then gradually increase step by step. Intermittent side, nowadays it is not used, so you can give the 3 high tidal volume breath, and you can go up to the PEEP plate of 40 cm of water. Series of large tidal volume not useful nowadays. A staircase method, that is nowadays many study using this staircase method, and maximal recruitment strategy and CT scan guided recruitment method. So one stage before recruitment maneuver, patient should be the hemodynamically stabilized, relatively hemodynamically stabilized. If patient required the fluid, give the fluid. Fluid reception should be adequate enough. Check for the pneumothorax and pneumomediastinum before going for the recruitment maneuver. Always check with, and should, you should rule out patient should not have the pneumothorax or pneumomediastinum. Check the SO2, check the ETCO2, check the compliance. This on the basis of ABG, and patient should be the adequately sedated, and neuromuscular blockade will be helpful some condition. So this is very good article published in World Journal of Critical Care Medicine. Recruitment maneuver in the acute respiratory distress syndrome. The safe way is the best way. The stepwise recruitment maneuver are better in improving. This stepwise recruitment maneuver are better in improving oxygenation with less hemodynamic stability. This is very important. ARDS with increased edema or atelectasis are good candidate for the RCM. recruited menorrhagia. Patient whose oxygenation improved with the increased pressure are at a lower risk of the death and post RCMP titration. This is very, very, very important. After recruitment, always titrate your PEEP level so to again avoid the collapse and overdistension. So post RCMP titration strategy should be the decremental method, incremental method, low inflection point method, ARDS net table, CT scan method, and USG method. Decremental and incremental method, you have to increase the PEEP by 1 to 2 and see whether the compliance of the lung is improved or not. And on the basis of that, you have to keep the PEEP. So this is the incremental and decremental method. In decremental method, you decrease from the high PEEP to the low PEEP, and incremental you can increase from the low PEEP to the high PEEP. But I want to stress here, always see the driving pressure. If the driving pressure is decreased by increasing the PEEP, it means the lung is recruitable. If the driving pressure is increased by increasing the PEEP, it means the lung is not recruitable, so don't increase the PEEP. Now, even after doing this recruitment maneuver, managing the patient on the driving pressure, if still patient is hypoxemic, then what will you do? So it the prone position, you are managing the patient on supine position. Now you go for the prone position. As we know that in the supine chest, the dorsal part of the lung is collapsed and more of the alveoli in the dorsal part, because of the gravity, there is dorsal gravimetric compression. If you are putting the patient on the prone position, then gravity will shift down and the dorsal alveoli become now able to open. So this is very good trial, Proceva trial, prone positioning in the severe acute respiratory distress syndrome, published in NEJM in 2013. And here they said that you have to keep the patient for the at least 60 hours to be left at least 60 hours in the prone position. And when will you go for this prone position? When the PF ratio is less than 150 mmHg with the FI2 of 0.6% and with the PEEP of the 5 cm of water or more, and tidal volume is close to 6 ml per kg of the predicted body weight, and it shows very good outcome. So how will you manage the patient if the patient on have the refractory hypoxemia? So is it based on the resource availability? So if the patient has the minimum resource in your ICU setup, minimum resources, then you can go for the recruitment maneuver, you can go for the prone positioning, and you can apply for the neuromuscular blockade. High indent gadget, so it can you can do the inhaled pulmonary vasodilation therapy, high frequency oscillatory ventilation. Nowadays it is not used for two trial, OSCAR trial and the oscillate trial. One trial is stopped because of the increased motility and one trial has a negative outcome, so it is not good enough nowadays. This is very good, transpulmonary pressure guided mechanical ventilation. Nowadays we can use it by going the esophageal pressure monitoring and the extracorporeal membrane based technique. We will not discuss about this. So what are the complications of the ARDS? The main complication encountered when managing patient with the ARDS, the barotrauma, that is the most important. It can cause the pneumothorax if you are giving the excessive tidal volume, then the lung which are more compliant get ruptured and causes the pneumothorax. I have seen one or two patient while increasing the tidal volume, patient develop the pneumothorax. Hemodynamic impairment can occur in such patients. Patient can develop the acute cold permanent because of the high CO2 and the ventilator associated pneumonia. So to conclude my ARDS presentation, ARDS must be identified. I diagnosis and the underlying cause is fundamental. Mechanical ventilation must be optimized on the basis of low tidal volume, enough PEEP, preventive pressure monitoring, adjunct therapy by giving the neuromuscular blockade and proning, and negative fluid balance should be achieved. Questions, and thank you.